people at the back can't hear me, just raise an arm and that'll remind me to speak up. Now, I'm afraid you may have come here under false pretenses because I don't have a prepared talk. I have some rather random remarks and then I hope we can have a discussion. I prepared the random remarks in great hurry for a small discussion group, so this is not what I knew was going to happen. Well, I'm immensely heartened by the way in which here at Oxford and some other places, Harvard, Rutgers, elsewhere, various groups have been started whose aim is to relieve the great suffering and early deaths of some of the world's 2 billion poorest people. I really admire this and applaud you for doing it. It is the greatest moral problem, I think, that we rich people are likely to face in our lives, and most likely to act in ways that are seriously wrong. I think in this area we face the following dilemma. Either we have moral beliefs that are very implausible or repugnant, or we have defensible beliefs where we break the link between our belief that we ought to do something and our intention to do it. I think it's clear that I ought to give much more than I intend to give. And that naturally provokes the response that I'm a hypocrite. You know, how can you believe you ought to give it if you don't intend to do it? Well, in this area, the only way of keeping, for most of us, the intention connected with the belief that you ought to do it is to have very, I think, indefensible beliefs. Now, I think that there are two main causes to which we can commit ourselves to give. I'm mainly going to talk about the one that has already started, giving to the poorest people in the world. I shall mention another. I think myself, if you commit yourself to giving 10% for the rest of your life, of your income, at least 10%, I would like to keep a clause which allowed it to be varied to this other cause, if that seemed at least as good. I'll come back to that. There's rather little to say philosophically about how much we ought to give to the poorest people in the world, because the basic facts and the basic arguments are very simple and clear. It isn't the case, as some of the submitted questions suggested, that our reason for believing we ought to give as much as we give is that we act consequentialists. You don't need to be act consequentialists to realize that you're failing to give what you ought to give. And I should start briefly with two non-consequentialist arguments. One I expect you'll be familiar with. It's Peter Singer's argument in his wonderful paper, Famine, Affluence, and Morality. Now, it's very easy to sum up. You're walking along, you see a child drowning in a pond. You could save the child's life, but you'd ruin your new suit or miss the opera you were going to. Well, everyone thinks you ought to save the child's life. Then, second, there are several children in the pond who need to be saved. Well, can you then say, oh, well, in that case, I don't need to save any of them. I mean, if there was only one, I ought to save him, but not if there are more than one. That doesn't make any kind of sense. Third, there are lots of other people who could save these drowning children, but aren't going to. Well, that doesn't justify my thinking, well, in that case, I don't have to save the drowning child if other people aren't going to do it. Well, then the final step is that the child isn't there a few yards away, but is far away in Africa or somewhere else in the world. Although that child may be in one way much less distant, because you could be talking to it over YouTube or what's it called? The other one, Skype. Now that argument isn't a consequentialist argument, because it is just very hard for people to believe that it isn't true they ought to save the child if there's more than one, or if there are other people who are not doing it. So everything rests on the fact, oh, I don't have to save their life at a mild cost to myself if they're far away. Now there are two strikingly impressive articles by Frances Cam in which she does defend the view that mere proximity makes a moral difference. But she doesn't persuade me. I can't resist saying Frances Cam has wonderful examples, and one of them is, suppose I'm in America, but I have very long arms that can reach all the way to India. What then would my duty be? Now, the second non-consequentialist argument is simpler and in some ways at least as powerful. Oxford's group called itself Giving What We Can. That name is, I think, in two ways misleading. One, it's a pity to say what we can, because obviously we could give more. Secondly, though, it uses the word give. And it seems to me fairly clear that the great wealth that we rich people have isn't, in a moral sense, ours to give. It's legally ours, but it's not morally ours. I'm not entitled to my vast wealth compared with these 2 billion people in Africa. There's no way in which I've come to deserve to have it and they haven't. Now, that assumption has been recognized in a way by people whose views are rather libertarian and right-wing. I mean, they quote Locke, that if you mix your labor with part of the world, the resources, then it becomes yours. But Locke adds, as long as you leave enough and as good for others. Well, we haven't done that to most of the poor people in the world. We haven't left them enough and as good. So Godwin, Shelley's father-in-law, said, every shilling in my pocket has received its dictates from the destination of, destination from the dictates of reason. What he meant was, so I needn't have quoted that remark, if you walk past a beggar and you don't give him your coins, on Godwin's view, you're stealing. Doesn't belong to you. He needs it more than you. You're stealing. Well, that is actually what I feel that we rich people in the way in the world today are doing. We're not entitled to our vast wealth. Rawls, who wrote a great deal on these distributive questions, regarded his main alternatives as utilitarians, but actually there's much less disagreement here than there is with the view that most people have, because most people believe that those who contribute more are entitled to their great wealth, their high income. But as Rawls says, their ability to work more effectively and achieve more is nearly always the result of morally arbitrary factors. And you're not entitled to what the market can enable you to get just because you have the good fortune to have these abilities and to have had a good education. So that, I think, is the main thing that leads me to think that my position is indefensible. If people from sub-Saharan Africa came and started removing my property, I wouldn't feel that I had a right to stop them. Now, I think that there are various moral truths and other normative truths that are as true as any truth could be, but I partly believe there are such truths because I believe that these truths are often very imprecise. So if we ask how much ought we to give, I think it's clear that if we give as little as 10%, we're acting wrongly. But if you ask me how much more ought we to give, I don't think there's a precise answer. There are some quite appealing answers, One is the answer that we ought to give our fair share of what would solve the world's problems if the other rich people also gave. Another is that we ought to give what would be required by a moral principle for giving, whose acceptance would be best, because it would have the best effects. Now, several people have pointed out that if a moral principle requires you to give too much, you're unlikely to live up to it. So as it were, you look for the moral principle, which is such that if people believed they'd be acting wrongly if they didn't give this amount, they would give most. And I think 10% is probably quite a good figure there. But that doesn't solve the problem, because even if most people ought to believe they ought to give 10% because that's what's going to have the best effect, they're not doing it. And we still know that we could save this young child's life for very little cost to ourselves. And that's going to be true again and again and again. So I think the best we can hope is that we know we're giving much more than most people, and we're not in that way blameworthy, but we ought to give more. And if you say, how much more? I think clearly the right answer is, the more, the better. Now, there are other practical suggestions to which I'll turn about how we should respond to this. But I first want to talk about the other, what seems to me, the other main alternative for people who believe they ought to give more and work more. These are what are called existential risks. And they're at the opposite extreme from the moral problems of global poverty. Those are very simple and straightforward. Existential risks raise very difficult questions, both philosophically and factually. I think that we're living now in the most critical part of human history. The 20th century, I think, was the best and the worst of all centuries so far. But it now seems fairly likely that there are no intelligent beings anywhere else in the observable universe. Now, if that's true, we may be living in the most critical part of the history of the universe. As you all know, if you represent the time from the Big Bang as a year, intelligent human life has existed for only a few seconds. And there are billions more years in which it would be possible. I said in my first book that if you compare three outcomes, peace, a nuclear war that kills 99% of the world's population, and a nuclear war that kills 100%, I think there's a much bigger difference between the second and the third than the second and the first. And that's because I do care greatly about ending humanity. Now, that's not because I believe that human history up until now has had great value. I'd have my view even if, as I sometimes do in my pessimistic moods, wonder whether, in Williams's phrase, it's all been worth it. So many people up until now have had such wretched lives that it's not clear that it would have been much worse if they'd never existed. However, we have no reason to think that our successors couldn't make things go vastly better. We can also assume that our successors wouldn't remain humans with human limitations and drawbacks, but would become in several ways more intelligent, better motivated than us, in ways that we can't even understand. And therefore, why this may be the critical period in the history of the universe is, if we are the only rational, intelligent beings, it's only we who might provide the origin of what would then become a galaxy-wide civilization, which lasted for billions of years, and in which life was much better than it is for most human beings. Well, if you look at the scale there between human history so far and what could come about, it's enormous. And what's critical is that we could blow it, we could end it. There are many ways in which human history might be ended soon. Probably nuclear war isn't one of them, but there are various others. The simplest is a really large asteroid. To guard against quite a lot of these dangers, we need to start colonizing other parts of space. Need to put a few people on earthly planets and then go further. So that's why when we have spread out, it'll be less critical. That's why this is the most dangerous period. Now, another point is that very many people completely disagree with my view that the difference between 99% or 100% being killed is much greater than no one and 99%. That's because people believe that if the human race ended, that wouldn't be worse for anyone, except for the particular ones in this generation. And so you can illustrate it, as I did in my book, by supposing that we discover some way of giving ourselves 1,000 years of happy, healthy life, but at the cost of sterility. And the entire present generation switches to that. They have their 1,000 years, and then it's all over. Well, there are many views about morality in which that wouldn't be significantly bad at all, because there's no one for whom it would be bad. Now, we may get back to talking about some of the problems there later, but my one alternative to causes to which we ought to give, my one alternative to relieving global poverty and suffering is supporting responses to those existential risks. And they couldn't be more different. One of them is so straightforward, immediate, simple, and urgent. The other is so philosophically hard to assess, factually hard to assess. But those are the two that mostly concern me. Now, I return then to some rather practical suggestions. Well, we need to decide how we can do most good. There are some difficult questions here. I know that I think it was Jeff McMahon or perhaps Larry Temkin was disappointed that the World Health Organization has drawn up rules for the value of saving life at different ages. And they have adopted the rule that saving the life of a newborn baby does more good than saving the life of a 10-year-old child. I think that's a mistake. So there are some questions there, but I think also there's a way in which stopping people from going blind is more straightforwardly demanding than saving the lives of young children. The difficulty is people desperately want to persuade themselves that they don't need to give, and they can think, well, the problem in sub-Saharan Africa is very largely due to the fact that they've had too many children. Now, if you switch to saving women and men in their 20s from going blind, no such thought has any relevance at all. It's obvious that you make a vast difference to that person for pretty little cost to yourself. Now, there are many other practical suggestions. First, it's clear that we should become vegetarians if we aren't already. That's heavily overdetermined now, and partly because, as I expect you know, cows produce 10% of global warming by emitting methane. Of course, we treat them terribly. That's absolutely clear. Second, we shouldn't have more than 2 children. And we should know that if we don't have any children, that's one way in which we're doing a lot of good or doing less harm. The children of we rich people add much more to global warming and thus to existential risks. Well, the next question is, should you yourself work in some effective aid agency, either here or going out into the field and saving people's lives and so on? I think there's a rather unfortunate fact here, which William McCaskill, who may be here today, has written about best, that actually you do more good if instead of joining an effective aid agency, you earned a great deal of money in a law firm or at the stock exchange and then gave a large amount of it away. Because the large amount that you gave away would employ someone else who would have done just as well as you did and several other people as well. And there's also a way in which, if that's how you try to do most good, you're, as it were, doing it most admirably, because actually working in an aid agency in contact with the people whose lives you save makes that quite rewarding as a way to live. Singer admirably reports studies which show that people who do give a lot tend to be happier, partly because it's very satisfying knowing that you're helping other people. Well, if the way you're helping other people is learning a great deal of money in law courts or at the stock exchange, that is not very rewarding. Trouble is, it may be the way in which you could do most good. So that's a difficult question. Now, I think one obvious objection to that proposal is that you couldn't be sure that you're going to retain the idealism that led you to become a Wall Street financier in order to give away. So, I mean, I also think there's a bigger general question here. How can we, when we're young and idealistic, and I think it is clearly true that people like you are much more concerned about this than older adults, how can you try to bring it about that you continue to give? Well, I have one variant on the proposal that you and others have adopted, which may seem rather cynical. I think it would help greatly if groups of young people who know each other well, I'm not sure what the optimum number would be, there might be 10 people, 20 people, and so on, they not only jointly pledge that they're going to give 10% in the rest of their life of whatever they earn, but there's an annual newsletter which gets sent to every member of this group, which reports those people who have cancelled their contributions. Now, some people regard that as rather cynical, but the fact is there are many people who would be able just to cease giving, but would find it hard to say, please tell the other members of this group that I'm not going to contribute anymore. So that's a little practical suggestion that I'm inclined to add. That's intended to affect your future motivation. Let me just throw in here another suggestion, which is quite unconnected with today's subject, but it's also motivation. It's much easier to do something that you decided you ought to do, but you're lacking the will, you're tempted not to do it. That's much easier if the cost of not doing it is much greater. And I now am much more effective in doing the things I've decided I must do, because I put them in the category of a gold star decision, and I've always kept every gold star decision. So if in the future I'm tempted not to do what I've decided I ought to do, then for the first time, here's a gold star decision that I haven't kept. The whole thing will start to fall apart. So you raise the stakes. Now, the way to do that is to start out with gold star decisions that won't be too difficult to keep, and then just build up. But several people have said to me they've adopted this and it's been a great help. Okay. I also think that particularly people in universities like this, probably the way that you could do most good isn't actually be going and working in the aid agency, but it's thinking of ways of more effectively raising money, more effectively getting it spent, and so on. I mean, to give just one example that I read recently, a proposal that, I mean, at the moment, foods that are sold have to list the percentage of sugar, fat, etc., etc., etc. Well, we could get to a state of affairs where all consumer goods would have requirements to list the ways in which they're related to global warming and other environmental ills. And then, you know, when we can't choose between the different sets of items and we see, well, one of them scores highest in environmental global terms, many people would do that. Now, a group which, as it were, got this idea and then got it adopted would do a great deal of good. So, also for some of us, we may think we do enough good if we stay in university and we persuade enough other young people to do more good. However, I have to come back to what I started with. I'm not giving what I ought to give. I'm acting wrongly. And I just have to try to do better. Now, there's nothing philosophically deep about these ways of getting myself to do better. It's a psychological, not a philosophical problem. Okay, well, I think I'll stop there. There are several submitted questions, and then we'll have other questions.
Parfit. We're just going to start off with two questions grouped in one.
Yeah.
I think you touched upon this in your talk. So is there a practical difference between consequentialism and other moral views with regards to how much money you should give and to whom? And giving what we can, ask people to give 10% of their income to effective charities, and they justify this number instrumentally. However, personally, justify the coherence of giving 10% of your income, but not 11%, 12%, or some other figure?
Well, I don't think there's any incoherence. And clearly, it would be a bad argument which said you could never justify giving only this amount, because that would go on up until giving everything. It's obvious that the most straightforward moral view, which makes fairly clear and extreme demands, is act consequentialism. But most of us are not act consequentialists. And there are other fairly plausible compromises, of which one, since the thing mentioned consequentialism, is rule consequentialism, which is the belief about how much we ought to give, that it would be best for us and others to accept and follow. Now that's not going to be precise, but it's a fairly plausible reply. So is Liam Murphy's reply. We ought to give the amount that we'd be required to give if everyone was doing their duty. You know, I'm going to do my share. The difficulty with all of those is that you just come across another child in the pond, though she's 2,000 miles away, and those defenses seem to fail. There's just no satisfactory solution here. So I think we should just aim to give a lot more than most other people.
This is a question from Roger Crisp.
Yeah.
He says, what do you think about the relation between self-interest and the overall good, as you allow that partial reasons can sometimes come into conflict with reasons to promote the overall good,
yeah,
and can sometimes override them?
Well, I think myself that we don't always have decisive reasons to do what's morally required. And I also think that if we're not bringing morality into it, and we're looking at the difference between impartial reasons and partial reasons, which I think Roger Crisp is doing in that. Let me mention in passing, when Sidgwick, for example, says that we ought to do what would make things go best, he wasn't discussing morality as we think of it. He was saying that's what we have most reason to do from an impartial point of view. Okay, that's got nothing to do with blameworthiness. Now, his great dualism was that he couldn't see how to answer the question when one act would make things go best and the other would be better for you. I think often there is an answer to the question of which you have most reason to do, but I think the strength of these different reasons is very imprecise, and that's because I think that if I could give up my life to save some number of strangers, that I have sufficient reason to do that if the number of strangers is 5 or 500. But in all of those cases, I'd also have sufficient reason not to give up my life. I don't think I'm rationally required to give up my life to save 500 strangers. It would be admirable if I did it. Well, if that's true, then since my reason to save 500 strangers 100 times stronger than my reason to say 5 strangers, the relative strength of these reasons is very imprecise. Now, I think it's in general true that although there are irreducibly normative truths, they are often very imprecise. And I think that's true of these.
So the third question is, you mentioned in your talk a lot about earn to give, where you go into a higher learning career and you give the money to effective charities.
Yeah.
Do you think that obligation is as strong as your obligation to give away money you already have? And are members who don't earn to give but have pledged 10% of their money as part of giving what we can philosophically incoherent?
I'm inclined to think that if you do enter a very high earning career, your obligation to give is going to be stronger than it is now. If the question is, do you have less of a moral requirement to adopt the policy of making a lot of money, I suppose I have to answer yes, because if that isn't the career you most want, you're making a sacrifice by doing it. Whereas at the moment, you know, you possess whatever money you possess and you can give some of it away. It isn't forcing you to not go to university so that you can give away more money, right?
And some members of Giving What We Can give 10% of their income to non-human charities, so specifically charities that work towards relieving animal suffering. What's your view on this, and do you think we should prioritise non-human suffering in our charitable giving?
I think it's absolutely clear that we should stop eating meat. And that's overdetermined in multiple ways. The suffering to the animals is the suffering we cause them, and we just shouldn't do that. I don't think there's a very high priority for the rather appealing task of going out and protecting herbivores from carnivores. But the case for vegetarianism is overwhelmingly strong, multiply.
And do you think there should be more research into ways of preventing animal suffering in the world?
I think that's probably covered by my answer to the last question.
So one of the...
I was very glad to read what looked like a fairly well-supported argument that insects aren't conscious, or at least can't feel pain. That was a great relief.
Well, now you've got that off our minds. In one of the pre-submitted questions, they quote Matthew from the Bible, who says, "But when you give to the poor, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing." And do you agree that charitable giving should be anonymous?
No, but for the same kind of reason. The point is, if your giving is well known, people will admire you for giving. And that may make your behavior less morally admirable than if you give it all and no one admires you because other people don't know what you're doing. But I think your aim shouldn't be to be morally more admirable. Your aim should be is to give as much as you can. And you're much likely to give more if your giving isn't secret. That's what's going on when people join these groups and they pledge together to give a certain amount. So I think the answer to that is clearly no. I mean, it's slightly like the fact Wittgenstein gave away all his money because he thought it was morally corrupting to be rich, but he gave it to his brothers and sisters. So he was just concerned with his own moral character, not with the people who needed the money.
And do you think there's a danger that increased drives for utilitarian altruistic giving will neglect political campaigns seeking structural changes?
Yes. I think that is important. I'm quite struck by some of the successes of some of the organizations that have sprung up newly, like Avars, which do have campaigns. And I do think that actually it's another partial counterexception to the commitment to give directly to the poor. I'm inclined to support organizations like Avars, partly because they seem to have done some pretty effective political campaigns. So I think that is very important. I mean, here's another example. What we need to get ourselves to give more is to somehow alter the causal pattern. And here are two ways of doing it. One, which would work perfectly, but which is impossible, would be for each rich person to know that there's one poor person in sub-Saharan Africa of which it's true that only I can help that person. She's entirely dependent on me. Then we'd all find it very easy to give away a lot. Very hard to arrange that. Here's another suggestion, though. If we could get a referendum in which all rich people would be taxed and that would be given to effective aid agencies, there are many people who wouldn't give it on their own, but who'd vote for the referendum because if it was going to affect a million other people, then they'd only give the same amount as part of a package with a million times as much good. Now that, you see, shows how politics can often achieve a great deal if you can get the right structure. So I'd be strongly in favor of movements like that. And I mean, another way of putting it is that it's really quite important that we shouldn't just have as our aim to be doing good and therefore feeling good about what we're doing. We should keep trying to think of ways of doing more good, and politics is one of them.
So the next question is relating to ethical theory, and should anything be done to help move understanding and discussion of ethical theory forward outside of academia? And if so, what would you suggest?
Well, I partly picked that one because I think the main problem is inside academia, not outside academia. My philosophical career has had roughly two parts, and I hope there'll still be time for a third. In the first part, I worked on particular problems, personal identity, time, future generations, and so on. Then, after I published my first book, Reasons and Persons, I got increasingly disturbed and alarmed by the number of good philosophers who just assumed that there couldn't be any normative truths. And that influence has spread. There's a quotation from what an economist said in a meeting fairly recently. He said, as economists often do, in my talk, I made no value judgments. And someone said, yes, you did. You said that if a policy is good for some people and bad for no one, we ought to adopt it. He replied, that's not a value judgment. Everyone accepts it. I mean, if it's come to the state in which that's what people think value judgments are. And I mean, the main thing that I was trying to do in my second book is to defend a view which I would have hesitated to tell to the people I know who haven't been to university, like one of my wife's best woman friends, I hesitate to tell what I've been trying to do. I've been trying to defend the view that we can have reasons to care about things for their own sake, that things matter in the sense that we have reasons to care about them. Now, it's only people who've been to university, I think, who think, no, 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 all reasons are given by desires and you don't have any reasons to give the desires. So it isn't outside academia that people need to think better about morality, it's inside.
With that in mind, so if we suppose objective moral values don't exist, then why would effective altruism matter?
Well, I assume they do exist. but it isn't just an assumption. I spend quite a lot of time in my volume 2 of On What Matters trying to defend the argument. I think it's quite important not to defend it just with respect to morality. I have a whole chapter in which I say that I think one of the biggest threats to people's confidence in moral beliefs is given by the fact of disagreement. I think the normative truths that I'm interested in are not empirically discoverable. There can't be evidence for or against. And in that respect, they're like logical, mathematical, modal truths. There are various truths for which you can't have evidence. Now, people then say, well, how do you form true beliefs? Well, in the case of maths, people don't have great doubt because the mathematicians nearly all agree. You know, we've got the ability to see this must be true given that. I think that we can reasonably hope that under ideal conditions, we'd have sufficiently similar moral beliefs and other normative beliefs. And one slightly heartening fact is that when people give this argument from disagreement, they often give, as the main example, the disagreement about abortion. Well, that's not worrying at all. You'd expect disagreement about borderline cases. There isn't disagreement about whether it's wrong just to kill any old adult for your own convenience. But I also think we need to appeal to other truths about reasons. Some of them epistemic. I mean, if you know that an argument is valid and has true premises so that its conclusion must be true, then I think those facts give you decisive reason to believe the conclusion. Now, that's a normative claim, but it's, I think, hard to deny that you would have a decisive reason to believe the conclusion. And there are many other areas, I think, in which there isn't significant disagreement about whether we have reasons to care about something, except among those people who've been corrupted by going to university. And I mean, in fact, I have in my book, that it's often blamed on Hume, but Hume believed you had reasons to care about things. And I list 13 passages in which he said that. When he wrote that notorious paragraph, 'tis not contrary to reason, to prefer the destruction of the whole world, etc., he was just forgetting what he actually, or he was making the trivial point that desires aren't beliefs, so they can't be false. However, I do think there are some very good philosophers who don't have the concept of a normative reason, which I take to be the essential normative concept. And that has the result that we don't actually disagree, because we're not thinking about the same thing. Yeah.
And do you think you've solved the central problem of moral philosophy in your latest book?
I don't. Well, I put that in. I don't think there is a central problem. I think that there are some difficult meta-ethical questions. But I mean, let me just quickly report, though it's a long way away from effective altruism. I'm just completing volume 3 of my latest book, in which I'm happy to announce, extremely happy to announce, that Peter Railton, one of the leading naturalists in ethics, Alan Gibbard, one of the leading non-cognitivist expressivists, and me, one of the believers in non-natural, irreducibly normative truths, we've resolved our disagreement. And the reason that we've resolved our disagreement is actually rather surprising. And I can introduce it with a sentence from Putnam in a recent book, Ethics Without Ontology. He says, "Nothing has done more damage to all parts of analytical philosophy in the second half of the 20th century than," now can you guess what's coming? "Quine-inspired ontology." The reason people have not believed that they're irreducibly normative truths is that they think that would commit them to adding weird entities to their ontology. Mackey said, "Too queer to be part of the fabric of the universe." And when I said to some length to Railton and Gibbard, look, there can be normative truths without there being a weird part of reality, a Platonic realm. They said, oh gosh. Well, then we're prepared to accept that there are indeed such truths. So, so they had been very badly pushed away by Quinean ontology. And I do think it's a huge mistake. The idea that you should deny that there are entities of all these kinds. There's a rather charming instance of this. Jonathan Benefit, of whom I'm very fond, said to me many years ago, surely you don't believe there are such things as shortages? Of course there are shortages. But, you know, he didn't want to commit himself to the existence of a shortage, because that would be a very strange entity. So I think this is another case in which philosophy has done a lot of damage. It's philosophy which has done most of the damage to the economists, because economists used to think that happiness and suffering mattered. It was only when people like Ayer came along that they had to avoid all value judgments.
So, in Reasons and Persons, you lay out the non-identity problem.
Yeah.
Given this, what are your thoughts on whether effective altruism should engage only with currently existing beings and not take into account any demands of justice from future beings?
Well, that rather saddened me, that question. I thought that people who thought about what I called the non-identity problem, in its simplest form, if we act in a certain way, energy policy, we may know we're going to greatly lower the quality of life 2 centuries from now. But then we realize that won't be worse for any of those people, because if we had a better policy, those people would never have existed. Would have been other people who would have existed and had a higher quality of life. Well, I thought that people would think that obviously makes no difference. So I said there are 3 responses to the non-identity problem. One I called the no difference view, and I hope people would assume it didn't make any difference. Alas, lots of people think that it does make a difference. And so that part of that book, insofar as it's affected people, it's had a bad effect. People think, well, it's not going to be worse for future people, so we have less reason not to do it. Well, I think there are other ways of trying to show that that's a mistake, but I won't slip into
doing that. Do you regret writing that chapter?
Yes, in a way. And another thing, I said that it was very hard to avoid what I call the repugnant conclusion. I'm now desperately trying to undo the damage, because quite a lot of people have sort of given up on the belief that outcomes can be better or worse, because they think, if you think that, then you can't avoid the repugnant conclusion. Perhaps you don't know what it is. It's the conclusion that, compared with the existence of billions of people living lives that are much better than the lives of almost all the humans who've ever lived, it would be better instead of the existence of those, if there was an enormous number of contented lizards or primitive herbivores, because the total sum of pleasure would be greater. That's one way. Now, it may seem fairly easy to avoid that by saying, well, pleasure isn't the only thing that's good, or it doesn't matter about the total pleasure. But there are other very difficult arguments towards the repugnant conclusion, and I think I do regret having got people to think asking about the goodness of the outcome is a mistake. So I'm now trying to answer the arguments for the repugnant conclusion in what I hope will be what I call the third part of my philosophical, when I can go back to the problems. I don't know why things went so badly. I looked recently at Frankener's article, Moral Philosophy at the Mid-Century, came out in 51. And he said, well, there are two main groups of moral philosophers. There's the naturalists who think that moral truths are empirically observable truths about the natural world. And then there are the emotivists who think there aren't any moral truths. And then he says, well, there are a few people who aren't in both those camps, who think there are these normative truths that aren't natural truths. And then he says roughly, but if they don't give a better answer to our objections soon, we're not going to take any notice of them. We'll just forget them. See how close it had come.
One last question from us before we open it out to the audience. Yeah. Why do you think that effective altruism has started to catch on as an idea now rather than in the past?
I don't know. It's very interesting. I don't know. I think there were similar sentiments when I was a student and a graduate student. I don't think people had sufficiently realized that it was worth trying to get movements going. I don't know what happened in the 80s and 90s. I believe that quite a lot of students became more cynical. But I just don't know the answer to that question. It's not a philosophical question. I mean, it may be because people are coming to think there can be normative truths again. I mean, give me another example. The person who taught me, and actually these things are always quite complicated, because he did care a lot about morality, Dick Hare. He did care a lot about it, though he thought there weren't any moral truths. But I quote a remark when he says a young Swiss friend of his came to him in despair because he'd read an existentialist novel which had convinced him that nothing matters. So Hare took his young friend aside. He said, my friend had thought that mattering was something that things might do, that if you looked at the world, you might see things mattering. But it's not that kind of word. When something says it matters, you say, whose concern? Now, it just wasn't part of Hare's scheme that anything might matter. He wasn't a nihilist who understood it and thought that nothing mattered. He didn't have the concept.
So now I'd like to open it to the audience for any questions. Brenda will be coming around with a microphone, so if you wait to her to get to you.
Great, thanks so much for coming and chatting. This was an incredibly interesting event. So it seems like one of the reasons that it's difficult to theorize how much of my income or your income we should give is that this begs a theory of justice that's bigger than just my own moral commitment. It begs the question of what should the actual distribution of resources in the world be? So I'm curious, one...
Well, that's why I thought the strongest argument was it isn't ours to give.
But I'm just wondering what theory of justice you're working with, but then...
Well, very sadly, although Rawls had this strikingly egalitarian view that you should do what would make the worst off people as well off as possible, He confines it to a nation state. He doesn't apply it to the world as a whole. So although utilitarians have no commitment to equality, utilitarians are much more egalitarian than Rawlsians. Now, there are some Rawlsians who want to apply Rawls's view to the world as a whole. But now, when you say a theory of justice, if it's just you're not entitled to it, they need it much more than you. Those are very simple. They don't need to be a theory, it's just obvious.
Would there be any attention to the basic structure within that theory? So I guess I'm curious what you think produces these inequalities to begin with and how we should think about that.
Well, a lot of it has been the natural environment. There's a book by Jared Diamond, whose details I don't remember, but he says one of the ways in which Africa has done worse than many other parts of the world is that there was only one tameable animal in most of Africa, whereas in the rest of the world there are many, and that's held them back a great deal. In some cases, there's no doubt. You had a community which had some natural resources, and because it was an island and could defend itself and it got a good politics, then things went well. But I don't think that entitles the people in the island in which things have gone well to be much better off than everyone else in the world. It's just their good fortune. And the only sense in which people, I think, could be said to be entitled to what they've earned is when they've sort of done extra effortful work. But if they earn much more than others just because they're more able, that gives them no claim at all. I mean, I always thought the charwoman who sweeps the floor in the hallway should earn more than the managing director. He wouldn't want to change places with her. So I do think, I just resisted theory of justice. I think the main claims don't have to be a theory. They're fairly straightforward. Yes. Well,
thanks for the
I should have said, if you do have children, make it clear to them that they're not going to inherit more than a little.
Thanks for the opportunity. And it seems to me you've said more about the altruism part than about the effective part. And it seems to me EA says, well, if we give too little money, we should at least give it to effective charity. So I have a question about this.
I think it's very important to work out which are the most effective ways to give. But I don't think that's a particularly philosophical. I mean, an example of a philosophical question there is whether saving the life of a newborn baby is more important than saving the life of a 10-year-old child. But most questions about how can we most effectively give are in large part empirical, I would think.
But is there one philosophical question? So I'm imagining two friends who both acknowledge they're giving much, much too little. They only give £100 to an ineffective charity. So one of them doubles the amount, gives £200 to an ineffective charity, and the other stays with £100 but gives it to a charity that is twice as effective.
Oh, yes.
So has one of them made a greater moral progress? Or
there's a very good point which Theron Pummer has made, I don't know if he's in the room, which is that if you do decide to give quite a lot, then you will be acting wrongly if you don't give it in the most effective way. And the parallel for that is the following case. Suppose you could save one person's life, but at some risk to yourself. So what we believed is, be admirable if you save the person's life, but because it's risky, if you decide to do nothing, that wouldn't be wrong. But then suppose if you took the risk, you could save two people, but you only save one of them. That would be very wrong, because the cost is the same, and you're allowing an extra person to die. So I do think if you've decided to give quite a lot of money, it's then wrong not to try to give it where it'll do most good.
Hi. Do you believe that we have a moral obligation to save a loved one over a stranger?
I'm inclined to think so, yes. I mean, I think that most of us are not act consequentialists, and this is one of the cases in which we're not. I think if you could save your own child or two strangers, you ought to save your own child.
Where do you?
I see the challenge from people who say, "Well."
Oh no! Actually, I was just going to ask, where do you believe the moral obligation stems from?
Sorry?
Where do you believe this moral obligation stems from?
Well, I think many people are not discussing the same thing when they discuss what they ought to do and what's right and wrong. They don't even use wrong in the same sense. But even if they're using wrong in different senses, there are quite a lot of questions about what would be right or wrong, on which I think nearly everyone would agree, and there's no serious skeptical doubt, unless it's one of these mistaken ontological worries, and so on. Now, in the case of saving your own child or two strangers, that's not a deep disagreement. And one of the reasons why it's not a deep disagreement is brought out by Sidgwick in the last part of his great drab masterpiece, Methods of Ethics, that he thought that actually things would go better if people weren't act consequentialists. But then, in this case here, things would often go better if people kept the strong loves and loyalties that do so much to make their life worth living, of which some are love and loyalty to your child. And to say, well, you should have that love and loyalty because then life will go better, but you shouldn't act on it, that's not a defensible view. And so there are different forms of consequentialism, and one is you ought to do what someone with the best motives would be motivated to do. And there's no doubt that someone with the best motives would care greatly about the welfare of that child. So that person would be motivated to give priority to the child they love.
Unfortunately, that is all we have time for this evening. We'd like to thank the St. Anne's Philosophy Fellows, and especially Roger Crisp, who've been so helpful in bringing Professor Parfit to speak to us today. There will be an opportunity to continue the conversation in the Union Bar with Professor Parfit, but for now, if you could all join us in thanking him for coming to speak today.